So this paper's by Antonio Castro, as you can see over there. I'm not Antonio Castro. I'm Richard Overdorf. So this is my R&D colleague who wrote this paper, but we're going to talk a little bit about phase noise and specifically some different types of ways to measure phase noise. And so let's get started. So most of us really have a pretty good understanding. I think in this domain that we're in right now, phase noise is important in multiple fronts. There's a couple examples here, but really what we're talking about is things for cutting-edge radar and communication systems. Phase noise is obviously limits for things like Doppler effects, and of course for digitally modulated communications. If you have phase noise, it affects the modulated symbols here by moving them in an arcing type of fashion. So again, that degrades our bit error rate performance and gives us some issues there. So of course, phase noise is very important. I'm going to talk about it in a couple different formats. So it's obviously instability in frequency, but we talk about it in kind of two domains. One is kind of the short domain, and the other is which is most common that we talk about for phase noise. And then the other thing I want to touch on a little bit is long-term stability, which doesn't manifest itself quite as much as in the phase noise domain. But specifically, we can measure a couple different methods. The frequency domain, which is very, very common, you see what single sideband measurements very frequently, specifically with a logarithmic plot. And then, of course, also in the time domain, for measurements that are close in, and for short-term stability, we can make those measurements in the time domain using a distributive process. So you can see that we have different contributors based on where they are in the phase noise plot. For the top plot, of course, is the frequency domain, and the bottom plot is in the time domain, where different types of noise contribute. And based on those types of noise that are dominant in your system, you may change the way you want to measure that device. So as I said, this is the quick agenda. I should note that the CD has a lot longer presentation with speaker notes that go into more details on the subject. This is really just an introduction. But we talked already a little bit about what phase noise is. I'm going to talk about really three different types of measurement techniques, and then add kind of another level on the two-channel cross-correlation measurement. And then we're going to talk a little bit about extending phase noise to higher frequencies. And then we'll quickly take a look at some time domain stability analysis with the Allen variance and domain conversion. And then finally, we have some new capability with our atomic frequency references that's for long-term stability that we'll talk quickly about, and then we'll finish up. So again, what is phase noise? So if you look at the two different things I was kind of mentioning already, it's really the basic concept of stability. And I kind of already talked a little bit about the short-term versus long-term. So the long-term stability is frequencies or frequency variations that really occur over hours or even days, where the shorter term is a subset of that, maybe a few seconds, but really even less than that is where we really see that manifest itself and make measurements in. So again, I'm going to talk a lot about the short term at the beginning, and then as we go forward, I'll talk a little bit more about the long term. But you know, people like NIST say that the ratio of the power density at a specific offset. So you'll hear us talk usually in the spectrum analysis domain. We like to throw the 10 kilohertz offset out there a lot of times. But of course, depending upon what you're looking at, if you're doing something like Doppler and you're looking for something that's slowly moving, you probably want to look for something that's really close into the carrier. If you have Doppler with higher velocities, then of course that's going to be further away from the carrier. So it really depends on and what your application is. But of course, again, different things contribute based on where you are in the noise curve. So what is phase noise? Again, I think this is pretty basic. Most of us probably understand that. But I do want to point out a couple things. So of course, it's changes in phase, which are pretty obvious. But what we also see a lot of times too is we also have sometimes amplitude modulation that occurs as well. And these things can also manifest themselves in that sideband. And we really want to, a lot of times we want to differentiate between if it's phase noise or AM noise. So I talked about the single sideband approach. There's a couple different ways we can measure this. You could take something like a standard spectrum analyzer plot and take a marker, a specific offset away from the frequency, and we have this band interval density marker where you can actually get a density from that marker. But you have to account for things like what is the noise bandwidth of your resolution bandwidth, and so there are some adjustments that you have to do in the spectrum analyzer to make sure you're calculating your phase noise correctly. Again, if you see that the power is in dBc per hertz, of course, so you measure from the carrier of the offset. And then, of course, a lot of times we like to use a log plot, and the typical spectrum analysis mode doesn't have the log plot. So I kind of touched on some of these already, but you tune the analyzer to a specific frequency. You can measure the density, but it really does have some limitations. I talked about the noise bandwidth in the RBW. So you have to kind of know what the filter shape is and the shape factor. Again, you have to know whether or not, you know, this is residual FM problems from your local oscillator inside the signal analyzer. The local oscillator stability as far as their noise sideband. So if you want to measure something that's closer in, you have a problem there. If the signal analyzer's LO and or its phase noise performance is worse than the device under test, then you obviously can't make a clean measurement with that. You'll be measuring the spectrum analyzer, not your device under test. We also have things like we use the peak detector and also log amplifiers. This can account for about 3 dB, 2.5 dB of noise. You can read something like AppNote 150 describes how this calculation is manifested, but it really has an effect on your end measurement. And then finally, especially at further offsets, you want to make sure that you're not running into the noise floor, and that's contributing to the measurement as well. The good news is most signal analyzers today have an internal application, a phase noise application, that gives you the capability to do a lot of different things, and it actually it takes into account a lot of these things that I just mentioned on this previous slide. So we have a lot of different things we can do here. We can monitor the spectrum, of course. We can do spot measurements. So if you want to see maybe the phase noise is changing versus time, maybe something's happening in the system where it's changing versus time, that's where you can do something like a spot measurement. You can see how the phase noise goes across time. And then, of course, it plots it in log form. As I mentioned, that's commonly not available inside of the SWEP spectrum analysis mode. Another nice thing that applications do, specifically this application from Agilent, we have a patented AM noise rejection technique where we can actually reduce the AM on the signal so that you can measure your phase noise without the AM component on it. This works for offsets less than 1 megahertz. And basically, it's a vector process that we use to be able to make that measurement. Another thing you might want to be concerned about is if you use an external reference, that reference can lock to the oscillator, of course. If it has something better in the close end, I really say about 100 hertz. I can see improvements within 100 hertz. This slide says 30 hertz. So if you have a really clean oscillator that you want to use for a 10 megahertz reference, that will improve your phase noise close in and improve your measurement results for the close in offsets. This is the signal path to be able to do that, which I'm not going to go into detail with. Again, looking at the phase detector technique, which is another technique not commonly in a signal analyzer, this basically takes a detector and takes the quadrature of the two, and based on that, you can see the phase fluctuations in a voltage output out of the output of the phase detector. So you can see those fluctuations versus time, and this is a common technique that is used for, I'd say, more advanced VCO and PLLs that have really good phase noise, where a direct method, as seen in the spectrum analyzer domain, cannot do a very good job on. So we really talk about two subsegments of this, really using a double balanced mixer here as the detector. You have a device under test, and then you use a reference oscillator that's locked with a PLL. You low pass you have a low pass filter to knock off, especially if you're doing really low frequency measurements. You really need to lock off the mixing components of the mixer. So you do that with a low pass filter. Then you have a low noise amplifier, and then you have a baseband analyzer, which in this case could be a spectrum analyzer. So the nice thing is you have one source that is the DUT, and then the second source. If you have a very good reference source, you can make a really strong phase noise measurement. on the frequency discriminator technique, basically the frequency discriminator is a method that is really an adaptation of the phase detector technique, where the reference source is now eliminated. Now you only need the device under test, so you don't need a really good oscillator. It's also, again, very similar to the PLL technique in that it uses a detector, in this case a mixer, but now we use a time delay, and as long as the time delay is accurately attributed to make sure that it's delayed to the other path, the delay line then converts that fluctuation into a phase fluctuation, and then once you have that delay line or phase shifter, you adjust it and make sure it's in quadrature of the mixer, similar to the last example, and then that phase fluctuation, just as I said, is converted into a baseband analyzer, which could be a signal analyzer. You can read those voltage differences and now measure your phase noise. So the frequency discriminator technique is, a method that the analog delay line degrades in sensitivity at really close-in frequencies. It's really good if with a DUT as a noisy source that has really a high level or low rate phase noise. Also, longer lines can really improve the sensitivity, but adding insertion loss and delay can really degrade the signal-to-noise ratio and the measurement sensitivity. Really, this is really good for free-running sources. So if you have something that is unlocked, that moves a lot, such as a cavity oscillator, this is a good technique for that. So we actually use the Hedrodyne digital discriminator. This is what we use in our N5052, which is a signal source analyzer. Basically, this is where the DUT is down converted by a mixer, so we can do it up to 26 gigahertz. The IF signal is amplified, and then we use an A to D converter in the digital signal processing, after the digital signal processing, to split the signal, and then we do the comparison in the digital domain. So this is a picture of it. Basically, it can measure unstable sources and oscillators. So if you want to measure a characteristic of how that signal, that oscillator, or maybe it's a voltage-controlled oscillator that moves versus time, you can make a lot of those measurements with this product. The dynamic range is really limited by the low noise amplifier and the ADC performance of the signal source analyzer. It's pretty fast and accurate, and it's really improved by coarse correlation, and we'll talk a little about what that means. That is not fast in many cases, depending upon how much correlation you want to do. So the cross-correlation technique is really a way to really improve your phase noise by doing a lot of numbers of correlations. So, it's essentially averaging. But if you look at this equation here, the lower the noise here, that contributes to your measured noise. So you want to make sure that this is minimized, but you take a signal or a system under test or a device under test, you split that signal into two different channels that are coherent, and then you do a whole bunch of correlations on DSP, you do a whole bunch of correlations, and based on that, you can get reduction in noise level. And conceivably, this could go for forever, right? I mean, you could get down to KTB if you really wanted to by using the correlation technique. So we do cross-correlation, again, as I mentioned, to reduce the measurement noise. It's, again, a two-channel phase noise for a PLL system or a two-channel Hedrodyne digital discriminator. It's really, again, well-suited for running oscillators. Measurement speed, of course, as I mentioned, suffers when you want to do a lot of correlations to get the lower noise level, but it is something that that is available for you. So I'm not going to go through this block diagram. This basically, we have some notes on exactly how this works inside of the DVD. Another thing we have is a phase noise measurement system. And this phase noise measurement system actually has a lot of capability in it. It uses both the discriminator technique with a PLL, or it can use the cross-correlation technique. So the system is somewhat complex, but it allows for a lot of flexibility between the overall system and performance. This shows the phase noise capability of that 5500 system. It also does pulsed phase noise, which is something else I should mention. And then for extending up to 110 gigahertz, basically these next few slides, which I'm going to go through very quickly, basically explain how we downconvert. Again, it's very important for things like radar. There's a lot of applications that this is important for. again, the more you have for a harmonic mixer, the more you mix up, the more you have noise at the end goal. So you have to make sure that that cascades through the system. This basically shows the uncertainty of a measurement versus the offset from the carrier and how much drift you have in the system. So the more drift you have, obviously the more uncertainty you're going to have in your measurement. And basically, you're not able to make close-in measurements. This shows the down conversion process of the 5502 that I mentioned. It has a down converter in front of it, and then we do the signal processing like I mentioned earlier. We also have options for 110 gigahertz where we use external mixers. And then here's a 77 gigahertz measurement example that you can refer to. I'm going to skip this. Again, here's the time domain. Basically, two different types, the Allen variants. We also have the modified Allen, most common, but it has really not very good confidence. And then we have the white noise and flicker. So we have a new application that does this measurement, and I'm going to show you here quickly. Basically, we have a new signal stability analyzer using a frequency counter that does that. You can see that here. That's available on MATLAB Central. So basically using MATLAB and one of these frequency counters. So we also have this in the digital domain as well. You can do the same thing both and correlate the time domain to the frequency domain measurement. We go through more detail on this in the slide set. Here's the data and more of the conversion. Last but not least, the interfacing with a new frequency reference that I mentioned at the beginning. Basically, what we do is we train the inside of the box. This is the FPGA inside a signal analyzer. This is for long-term stability. So basically, what we do is we detect a one pulse per second based on a cesium standard. So it's very, very concrete as far as its repeatability. We compare that, and then we adjust our time base over time. So here's the summary very quickly. We're done. I'm sorry. I went over. There's more slides here than I was expecting. So thank you very much.